Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to our Maunday Thursday worship experience. We're glad you're here, and you can see we are ready to share in the Holy Meal. So we're glad that you're here to do that with us. I'm Pastor Will Clark. You're at Isle of Faith United Methodist Church, and if you didn't know it already, this is Holy Week. It has other names, Passion Week. You can understand that, the Passion of Christ, right? So most of the year, every Sunday is its own Sunday, right? We celebrate Sunday, read the scriptures, proclaim the word. But Holy Week, from the beginning, right before the Palm Sunday service to the end of our Easter service, is really one worship experience with just a few different opportunities to celebrate. So this is, we had Palm Sunday, now we have Maunday Thursday, and we're going to tell the next part of the story. And then tomorrow we would go to the next part of the story with Good Friday, where this, we call it a celebration, but that's, you have to really understand, that's kind of a dichotomy, right? It's the day that we recognize that Jesus died on the cross for us. Now that doesn't sound like a celebration, but think about it. It was that gift that led to our ability to be forgiven and refreshed and renewed to eternal life. So we can celebrate the hope in Christ. And then you have to come back, of course, Easter morning, where we will celebrate the risen Lord. So there you go. We have three opportunities to worship. Four if you want to come twice on Sunday, and you're welcome to do that. You saw the announcements. The Bible study, the only one I'm going to tell you about right now, will start two Sundays from today, not counting today. So not next Thursday, but the next Thursday. And it will be the book of Revelation, 6:15 to 7:15, and we will start out, because I have high hopes, in the fellowship hall, and then we'll go from there. But you will love it, I promise. You will leave there, whether you agree with it or not, you will hear an explanation of Revelation that will lead you to understanding that that is a book of hope to get people through the hardest of times. And if you know how to read it, it is a picture of the promised heaven that Christ prepared for us. So that's what we have to do tonight. I'm going to invite you, if you would like to stand, and we will share in our opening prayer. It's a call to worship together. Your part will be in the green. It's kind of hard to tell, the yellow. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Amen.
It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet. Drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him,
Lord, are you going to wash my feet?
Peter, you don't quite understand what I'm doing now, but in time you will.
Lord, you will never wash my feet.
Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you cannot be my disciple.
What am I supposed to do? I believe this man is king. He's God. I believe he's going to rule the entire world and bring glory to Israel, and I'm going to be by his side. I've seen him heal lepers. I've seen him raise the dead. I've seen him feed thousands from the lunch of a little child. I've seen him talk to Moses and Elijah and heard God's voice in the cloud, and yet he wants to wash my feet like a common slave? I don't understand. I remember when he first came to me and he asked me to follow him, and I was so filled with shame that I turned him down, and yet he continued to pursue me. And every word, every moment, every touch, every look convinced me that he cared about me so much that when I saw him walking on water in a storm, I called out to him to meet him in the storm walking on the water, because I was so sure that he so loved me that he would never let me drown. Everything in me tells me this is wrong, but my soul screams for him. He's given me hope. He's given me life. He's even given me my name. I want all of him. Lord, just not my feet, but my head and hand as well.
Peter, those who have taken a bath are already clean. They only need to wash their feet. But you, Peter, and you, you're already clean. Do you understand what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and it is so. And if I, being your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's. I have shown you an example so that you would do this for one another. A slave is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Blessed are you if you do what I'm showing you. I give you a new commandment, to love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also ought to love one another. By this, the world will know that you're my disciples.
So we have shared in the word of the Lord, shared through the reading, we've seen it acted out. I hope you were able to experience what it's been like to ask Jesus not to wash your feet, that you're not worthy, but then to come to realize by the love of our Lord, we are made worthy. So praise God for this sharing in his holy word. In that scripture, we heard that we are invited into this ministry with Jesus. But he also says that we must be made clean. And that it is his blood, it is what he does for us that makes us clean. So before we share in this meal this evening, and before we come, as you would be invited, maybe I'm not supposed to talk tonight. So before we would do this together. Again, I will have some words, and then you will have confession. Another mic, though. This doesn't work. We're going to go grab a megaphone out of the children's ministry. Hopefully you'll be able to tell when your part comes up. I'll let you know. Let us pray. My sisters and brothers, Christ shows us his love by becoming a humble servant. Let us draw near to God and confess our sin in the truth of God's Spirit. By your Spirit, is faithful every time of trial. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our confession. Forgive us, Lord. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. But Christ suffered and died for us and raised from the dead and ascended on high for us and continues to intercede for us. Believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. And amen. There's a story of a little church that had an unusual ritual. Every Sunday, the members of the church, at a particular time, would stand. They would turn together to the right and sing the Gloria Patri. It was a nice tradition. They've done it as long as they could remember. Well, then a newcomer came to church and just curiously asked, "Oh, this is interesting. Why do we do this? Why do we turn to the right?" Interestingly, no one could remember. No one knew why they turned to the right. It's just something they'd always done. And they've done it together. And it meant something to them. But that wasn't good enough for this newcomer. He was curious. So he kept asking. And finally he came across an older gentleman that had been in the church a very, very long time. And the old gentleman thought about it. He said, "You know, I remember now. See, there was a time when we did not have a screen and we could not afford hymnals. So we had a wonderful, talented artist in the church, and she painted the words to the Gloria Patri on the wall. So every Sunday when it came time after the offering, we would stand, turn and face the wall, and sing the Gloria Patri. Well, over time, we bought hymnals and got a screen. The wall was painted numerous times. But the little church never stopped turning to the right and singing that song. They didn't know why they did it, but they just did." Don't we often lose the real significance of important things? Somebody was asking me, I was talking to Al actually earlier, and he was glorying and was happy about the 10 years he'd been married to Jude. Is that right? 10 years? 14, something like that. He told me a year. Maybe he was wrong too, 14. But I responded, "Yeah, we've been married 30. It's over 30. It's after 30, you know, it's just a long time." So I felt bad. Maybe I'm losing the real significance of being married, such an enduring, loving relationship. But we do things, and we often forget why we do them. Or we just get comfortable in our actions and our traditions. Unfortunately, it's true that for some, either they never learn the real reason, or we forget the significance even of our most sacred rituals, such as the Lord's table and Holy Communion. It sounds like I would make this up, but you've been around some, most of you, church before. You know it's true that there are actually people that when they knew Communion Sunday was coming up might stay home so they wouldn't have to. You've heard of them. You know who they are, right? So it's lost some significance for some. We live in a fast-paced, technological world. Our society is all about getting things done quick, moving from one thing to the next. We often just go through the motions, our daily routine, even our religious routine. We rarely stop to consider the meaning of many of the things we do. We just do them because they need to be done. Unfortunately, in worship, there are things that are a regular part of our worship that if we're not careful, we could lose the significance, not only of our sacraments, but some congregations have special songs. Maybe it was the first song that was played on that organ when the church was built. For some, there's a special painting that was dedicated by patriarch or matriarch. Perhaps you're a visitor or you're new to church and you don't understand, what is this doxology thing? What does that mean? And why do we sing it after we give money? It's always been done that way. We just do what we do because that's what we do. And you know, most of us are really satisfied with that explanation. You visit a church, you want to fit in, you see what everyone else is doing, and you just follow right along. And hopefully you're even moved by it. But tonight, on Maunday, Thursday, this Holy Thursday, let's examine this meal that we're about to share. Look at it a little bit closer. See, understanding the history of the Lord's Supper is important. It helps us understand why we continue to do it time after time. Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, gives us an account of that last meal from which we get most of our liturgy that we use for Holy Communion. And then John's Gospel in chapter 13, that is what we experience this evening with Al and Rob, Peter and Jesus. It tells the powerful story of the foot washing. In Luke chapter 22, the traditional Passover was approaching, and Jesus instructed his disciples to go make preparations for the occasion. The Passover meal was a Jewish festival, been in place long before Jesus and the disciples came into town. And it commemorated the Exodus from Egypt, when Moses was called up to the mountain and given orders by God to go back and set my people free. The bread and the wine were a very traditional part of that Passover meal. The table of Passover meal traditionally has 5 cups, which is what we have on the table this evening. 4 of the cups symbolize the people's joy and gladness. And it recalls one of the 4 terms that the Torah uses to remind people of the redemption they received from Egypt. Exodus chapter 6, 6 through 8, you hear, I will bring you out. I will deliver you. I will redeem you. I will take you. They remember that God had them in his hands and delivered them. Now the 5th cup is called the cup of Elijah. That would have been the cup Jesus lifted during our communion scriptures. It was a cup of wine that was set on the table in the hope that the prophet Elijah will grace the table and speak of the coming Messiah. It spoke and represented a time of universal peace. Elijah's cup also symbolizes the welcoming of others to the meal. Others can come in and share with the family, whether it be someone who is hungry or in need or lonely, or perhaps just a neighbor. The bread, or the matzah, also reminds the people of the Exodus. In Exodus chapter 12, 33-34, it reads, "The Egyptians urged the people to hasten their departure from the land, for they said, 'We shall be dead.' So the people took their dough before it was leavened, with their kneading bowls wrapped up in their cloaks on their shoulders." See, they didn't have time to knead and allow the bread to rise. So in this particular Passover, the one that we read about in Luke 22, Jesus gave the elements of bread and wine new meaning. In verse 14, he says, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." Jesus was on his way to Calvary. He knew that. And he was going to use the bread and the wine to explain the significance of what he was about to do for the world on that cross. See, the Passover was under the old covenant. It was a Jewish festival celebrating God saving his people. But Jesus' death on the cross seals the new covenant. The old covenant involved forgiveness of sins through the blood of animal sacrifices. In the new covenant, Jesus will become the Lamb of God. Jesus will become the sacrifice on the cross for all people, for all time. John the Baptist, who was a forerunner of Jesus, cried out, "Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world." John 1, 29. See, his blood would be effective in removing sin from all who place their faith and trust in him. Jesus' sacrifice will not have to be repeated over and over again. There would be no need for money changers to buy doves. There would be no need for priests specially skilled in sacrificing animals. Jesus took that on for all people, for all eternity. Jesus was drawing on the disciples' knowledge of the Passover event, which they have done all of their lives. Their knowledge of the sacrificial system, so that they and that we might better understand what it was he was about to do. He wanted us to see the relationship between the old covenant and this new one. The significance of this particular Passover, or Last Supper, is that Jesus knew and wanted to reveal to the disciples that the time had come for the long-awaited and promised new covenant. With that meal, Jesus instituted the sacrament that we call Holy Communion, or the Lord's Supper, where the bread and the wine of the Passover meal reminded the people of the Exodus and the Old Covenant. Jesus became the source of the new covenant. He became the very event of the new covenant. He said, "Do all of this in remembrance of me." The point of the Passover Seder meal was so the people would remember God's delivering them from Egypt. The purpose of our communion meal is so we remember that Jesus Christ delivers us from our sins. He said, "Taking the bread, this represents my body, which was given for you." And he took the cup and said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant, my blood, which is poured out for you." So what's the significance of what we are about to do for us? Jesus is saying that every time you take the bread and the cup, I want it to remind you of me and of what I did for you. Sometimes we do not stop to appropriately think about that. So just as the Passover was a very significant reminder of their deliverance from slavery in Egypt, so the Lord's Supper celebrates deliverance and freedom from sin through the blood of Jesus Christ. Perhaps we need a greater awareness of the significance of this service, so that the sharing of this meal and the humble act of washing feet, washing one another's feet, will be a reminder of God's great love for us. Holy Communion is, after all, a means of grace. It's a way for us to experience the love of God, actually experience it. We should come into God's presence with a thoughtful and repentant attitude, which is the reason why we shared in the confession and pardon earlier. So in what ways have we missed the opportunity to experience God through this sacrament? In what ways may we have overlooked the significance of the new covenant sealed by the body and blood of Jesus? In what ways have our actions or thoughts perhaps disappointed God? Well, our answers to those questions are personal and varied. And some of you probably have wonderful examples of how meaningful the sacrament is for you and your family. But whatever the case, wherever you are, and whatever your experience has been in the past of the sacrament, tonight you're invited to come and receive a new cleansing of sin. Christ desires to cleanse you and to cleanse me. So come and be at peace with God. Come and receive freedom and liberty from the power of sin over your life. Come and receive God's healing. If lately Holy Communion or coming to church or even being a Christian has been like turning to sing Gloria Patri to a blank wall, then let tonight be a new beginning. Let tonight be a night where you understand in a new, personal, and special way. Tonight, come in humility and receive the gift of grace. Let it strengthen your faith as you remember the promise of eternal life. As we share in this meal and as we both allow our feet to be washed and stoop to wash another's, remember the sacrifice and the suffering of Jesus our Lord, the suffering servant. Remember the act of love, of saving grace. The liturgy of Holy Communion is really a prayer, and it walks us through the story and reminds us of the great love of God and what he's done for us. So join me in this prayer of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. From the earth you bring forth bread and create the fruit of the vine. You formed us in your image and delivered us from captivity and made covenant to be our sovereign God. You fed us manna in the wilderness and gave grapes as evidence of the promised land. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When we had turned aside from your way and abused your gifts, you gave us in him your crowning gift, emptying himself that our joy might be full. He fed the hungry, healed the sick, ate with the scorned and forgotten, washed the disciples' feet, and gave a holy meal as a pledge of his abiding presence. By the baptism of a suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. The night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he raised it, giving thanks to you, our Father in heaven. He broke the bread, shared it with the disciples and said, take and eat, for this is my body broken for you. As often as you eat of this, do so in remembrance of me. Supper was over. He took the cup again, gave thanks to you, shared it with his friends and said, drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink from this, do so in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, now and forever. Amen. Body of our Lord, broken for you. Blood of our Savior, shed for you. As mentioned earlier, not only are we blessed and honored, humbled, to share in this meal, but we also have the opportunity to share in acts of servanthood as we both have our feet washed and wash others. It's not mandatory. We know some people are weird about feet. I get it, right? And I know you're thinking, because I've been there, oh, I didn't wash my feet. I have hose on. I've got a hole in my sock, right? Look, we're at church. We love each other. This is about Jesus and humility. So don't worry about any of that. We don't care. Don't rob yourself of the experience out of embarrassment or pride. Maybe just a little unsure. It's not mandatory. But I'm going to ask the servers to come forward and those who are going to wash the feet. And Rob will wash my feet, and I will wash Rob's feet over here first, and you can watch that if you would like, and we'll model for you. Now look, we're not washing each other's feet like Peter and Jesus did. This is a symbolic washing. So if you choose to do that, here's how we're going to do it. This station to my right, to your left, this is the family and friends station. After you receive communion, if you would like to wash one another's feet, maybe your spouse, your best friend, your children as a family, people that you know, or perhaps you just want to wash a stranger's feet, that's fine. You come over here. If you would like just to have your feet washed by myself or Jude or Al or Rob, then come to this station and we will wash your feet. You just take off one shoe. That's all you need. You're welcome to take off two. Once you, we're just going to put a little bit of water on the top of your foot, let you feel the cool water, and then we will use a clean towel to wash, to dry your foot. That's it. So you're invited. The communion servers can come forward as well. And as you're led, you're not going to be, we won't have ushers lead you down. As you are led, come to one of the stations, take communion. You can stay at the rail as long as you'd want, and then go to whichever foot washing station you would like or back to your seat. Jesus left this table so 1,000 years ago. He left turning the remembrance of one salvation into the promise of another. But he also left knowing that where he went was to betrayal, persecution, and to death. When he left that table, he knew he was going to be our sacrifice. So that's our call tonight. We leave here as disciples of Christ to be a sacrifice. Jesus said, pick up your cross and follow me. So Easter's not here yet. So we're not going to celebrate that tonight. Tonight, leave here knowing and remembering the great sacrifice that Jesus made for you so that you might live. Go in peace.